Okay, guys, welcome back. Before we start, a quick announcement. Today is your due date for the assignment 3, and almost immediately you're going to have open a new assignment, assignment 4. Assignment 4 is all about object-oriented programming, what we start reviewing in the previous week. And as usual, you have 1 week, so your new assignment is due next Monday. Remember, assignments usually are due Monday. Today, use the exception because we have the exam. So use assignment 4, please, in your schedule, in your calendar, due next Monday, the 4th. And assignment 3, today, please submit. Remember, your assignments, more or less 5% each. Final exam. So far, we have complete 2 midterms. So the last one, the final exam, is going to be our last day. So we finish with the class July the 9th. That is, we complete this week, next week with only lectures, and then we are in the final week, and Thursday we're going to have the exam. As usual, 1 day before, in this case, Wednesday, I am going to do a review, and I am going to try to do a full review. So you have the opportunity to check things and present your exam. Talking about exam and assignments and so on, at this point, we have complete almost 68% of the class. Right now, TAs and graders are working. By the end of this week, you are going to have your 2 exams graded. So that means that you are going to have this week 30% of the 50% that represent exams. It's only 1 exam missing in the final, and all of them are with the same weight. So it's 1 of 3. Assignments. You are going to submit the 3rd assignment today. Usually the graders and the TA grade the assignment the same week. So I am hoping that by the end of the week or during the weekend, you are going to have 3 assignments and the grade for them, which basically mean 50%, and 2 more assignments coming, 2 or 3, depending of how fast we can move. But more or less, 50% of your grade of these 25 is going to be reported. We're going to review recursion. So hopefully if we cover the topic, yes, the topic is going to be in your final. Remember, the exam only include what we review during the lectures. So I am going to try to cover everything, including recursion. But if we do not cover the topic, I do not put questions about it in the exam. Now, the labs. We are almost done with the labs. You're going to have 3 labs this week, next week 4 labs, and the last one another 3. So around 10 labs, 9, because you have the review of the exam this week. So more or less, and this is an approximation, at the end of this week, you are going to have complete 20 labs and all the labs graded, which basically mean 20 of the 25% that represent the grade, which the labs. So my point is, by the end of the week, you have in your grades on Canvas, you can review 68%, almost 70% of your final grade. So there is only around 30%, let's see, 30% of your grade to be done. At this point, given these numbers, the minimum to pass is 75 in numbers. I mean, that is the minimum number in order to grade a positive passing grade as a final, a D. So at this point, at least, if you do the math of your grades, you should be at least about 35 over 100. So if you have 35 over 100, you still could pass the class, assuming that you get full points in the exam and every activity that is coming. Other case, there is no way. Remember, there is no extra credit. I am right now, there are five people with A plus. So if everything go in the same way, five of you are receiving A plus, and a lot of you are receiving A's, A minus, B, B plus, and so on. So the grades are kind of high, which is good. Congratulations for that. But my point is, because the grades are high, there is really no expectation for a curve or for an increment. So if you have your grades not as good as you want, C's, B's, the best thing that you can do is start working in the exam, prepare yourself for the exam, review everything that you could have missed in the previous exams, complete your assignments, and do not miss any lab. Because again, there is at least 10% of your grade, 10 labs that are running. The main reason, because some people is below B, the main source of missing points is missing labs. So if that is your case, my recommendation, 10 more labs coming, try to complete them and be sure that you get those 10%. It could be helpful. So that is regarding grades. By the end of the week, hopefully you have all of this. Review your grades, plan for the next 3 weeks, and start working for the exam. The third exam, the final one, obviously comprehensive, but the topics that are coming are probably the most challenging, including recursion and arrays. Those two topics could be very interesting. You are going to use them a lot in your next courses, so we need to review them carefully, but they are obviously challenging. Moreover, they are the last topics, so you're going to have a little bit less time to practice, because so far, whatever happened with your exam yesterday, we're going to continue working with for loops, if else, variables, and other things. But for the new topics, well, we have 3 weeks, basically, right? So review the topic and do some exercises and practice, but immediately we have the final exam. Good. So this week, during one of the labs, probably Tuesday, the TA and the grader are going to work with you to review your exam. So they are grading the open questions. You're going to have an announcement telling you that your exam is graded. Once you receive the announcement, the exams are graded, review your exam, and any question that you could have, you're going to have the opportunity to ask them directly during one of the labs times, probably Thursday. So do that first, and then if there is still any question, then you can contact me. My request for you, first, talk with them, because they are the ones grading your exams. So if there is any mistake or anything that they miss or you want to review, they are the original source to check things. Obviously, if something didn't work or if you want to talk with me after talking with them, please send me an email and we can talk. But that is going to be probably by the end of the week, during the weekend or next week, because you are going to be reviewing your exam with them Thursday. Good? So that is the exam, the assignments, your grades. Let's see. Now, continue. Suggestion for study. There are several websites that you can use. I think the TA shared with some of you or with all of you. I'm not sure, but you can ask him, a web page that you can use. The textbook have exercises that you can use. My recommendation, if at least you run, compile, and understand the programs that we review in the lectures or the programs that are on the slides, that is first step, and that could be, should be what you need for the exam at least. Other than that, you can Google it. There are several sites in which you can practice Java. There are several web pages in which you can basically do the program, and the computer, the web page, tell you if your program is good or bad, if correct or not. Practice. I'm going to ask him to share the link with all of you, just in case he didn't do that. But I remember reading a message with that particular link for a site with practice programs. Good? Okay, so moving forward, next step. Something that we check in the previous lectures is classes. Right now, we're working with programs that are using several classes. In particular, I want to talk about those classes that are not the class with the main method. I want to talk about those classes, student, professor, triangle, box, and so on. The classes that we're using to represent objects. As any other class, those classes have variables and methods. This week, today in particular, I want to talk a little bit more about methods. When you create a class, you can put inside of the class any number of variables, any variable, any type. You know that. Also, you can create inside of the class any method, any number of methods with any name. However, there are some methods, some particular methods with particular names that exist in any single class. So when you create a new class, a recommendation for you is, you know what? People is going to expect that your class have those methods. Think about this. You can build a new house and you are free to build your house in any way that you want. However, there are some particular spaces, some particular things that anyone is expecting you to put in that house. Think about that like these particular methods that doesn't matter which class you create. You can put whatever methods and variables you want, but usually programmers, other people, is going to expect that you put these particular methods in your class, additional to any other thing that you put there. I am talking about constructors. Someone asked me about them before, so today is the day that we cover constructors. I am talking about a method called toString, and I am talking about methods that we call getters, and methods that we call setters. So toString is a particular name for one particular method. Constructors, getters, and setters, they are categories. So there are going to be several constructors in one class. There are going to be several getters, and there are going to be several setters. These are categories. And this is one particular method. And obviously I want to show you examples of each of them and explain to you why anyone expect you as a developer of a new class to put those methods there. Now, before starting with the constructors, I just want to be sure that we remember the elements that any method should have. When we talk about a method, you remember, first, the first thing that is going to be public, remember? For variables, for method, public. Today, I want to mention, and we talk about this in the first week, that, well, there is public and there is also the opposite, private. The first thing that is going to be when you create a new method is the word public, that is the one that we're using, but we're going to review some cases in which we can put private instead of public. Whatever. What is the second time? After public, what we put? Do you remember? In the week 1, 2, 3, and 4, to create a new method after public, exact. Public static, but then we learn that it can be nothing, right? Because the static is optional. We already review what are the consequences of using static or what happened when we do not use static. So public or private, one, static or nothing, two, and then in our first examples, the next thing was void, remember? But something that we learned the previous week is, well, it's not only void. We can put any data type, remember? Because we review return, and that void basically represent a method that return nothing, all the things that we did in the first weeks. But now we know that we can put int or double or string or whatever, and that method is going to return exactly that kind of value. And if we put any data type, then we need to use the keyword return inside of the method. Previous week. Public, static or not, void or not. Next. The name of the method, remember? Next. The parentheses. Now, something that we review the previous week is that we can use something inside of the parentheses. We talk about parameters, remember? How many parameters can I have in a method? How many things I can put inside of the parentheses? Option one, nothing, zero. Use as we did the first 4 weeks. Use empty parentheses, nothing inside, open and close. Or I can put inside as many parameters as I want. Each parameter is a variable, a local variable. Each parameter is going to have a data type, a name, and if I want another one, I can use the comma, and again, I need a data type, another name, and I can continue with this thing and create as many parameters as I want for my method. After that, open curly bracket, closing curly bracket, and here, you put the body of the method. We're going to call body to all the instructions that you put inside of the method. So these are the elements that we use to create methods. And we have been creating methods since the beginning, since the first day. We start with main. The first lab that you did was one class with the main method. Hopefully today, every single part of that main is clear. Well, except one, the brackets, the string brackets, arrays that we need to review next week. So, any single method that is going to have these elements, and particularly, I want to talk about these categories of methods that we need to put in our classes and why we need to put them there. So, first, constructors. Let's talk about constructors. I am going to start with the example and then go back to the theoretical description. This thing here, do you remember when you create an object, you use new, and you put the name of the class here? But you put the parentheses there. So is the name of the class with parentheses. Parentheses is a method, right? Looks like, well, that is the name of the class, that is the type. Anything that have parentheses is a method, anything. In particular, this crazy method that has as a name, remember, any method have a name? That method that have as a name, the name of the class, that one is a constructor method. Constructor, a method with the same name that the class. Don't worry, I am going to explain getters and setters. It's going to be the last one today, but I am going to explain. Getters are methods which the name get something, and setters are going to be methods with the name set and something else. I am going to describe that later. So constructor is a method with the same name of the class. In this example, what you are doing there is call a method. Here, when you use new, the next thing that you do is call the method with that particular name. So, yeah. Let's see. If I have a class and this class have a main, and inside of the class, I create an object. I'm going to create a box. And that object is equal to something new. You know that there, I am expecting to have, again, the name of the class. And notice, the name of the class, uppercase and lowercase. Then, parentheses. We already did this. Now, what I am explaining to you is, this guy here, the name of the class, this one is the name of the class. This one is the type for the variable. This is the keyword to create the object. This one is calling a method. Which method? The method box is a method that have the same name of the class. That guy is a constructor. Now, if I show you my class box is something like and inside I can put variables and methods and the things that we have done before. Number one, always, always, always. Even in this class that you can think is empty, there is no class empty in Java. Even if you do not put anything, even if you do not write anything there, always, 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 you have here inside of any class, by default, the following code. What is that? This one is this method that I am calling when I create the object. Just because always, 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 in order to create an object, you're going to do new name of the class and the parentheses, something that Java is going to do for you. Always, Java is going to put a method with the name of the class inside of any class that you create. Again, you can put this green thing in your program, but even if you do not put this by default, you have one of them. Obviously, you have one, and that one is empty, just like the one that I am writing here. It's a method, it's empty, it's not going to do anything. However, what is happening here is that you are calling the method, just as usual, you call the method. When the method finish, the method is going to return to you. Obviously, you are thinking like, and if the method is empty, why we are calling the method? Well, I am going to talk about it. But before that, notice the following. Number one, the method have the same name of the class. Is the only method that have a name with uppercase letter at the beginning, because the name of the class start with uppercase. The constructor should have the same name of the class, therefore you keep the uppercase. So the first letter, uppercase, is the only method in which the first letter is expected to be uppercase, because need to be the same, not similar, the same that the name of the class. Two, all the methods have public or private. This one also, this one is public. Second, all the constructors, every single constructor is going to be a method, no static. You cannot use static with constructors. Why? Because remember, static is for class method, class variables. The constructor is the one that you are going to use to create a new object with the word new. In order to match the idea of new object, constructors are never static. You never use static for the constructor. Another rule, any single method, all the methods have void, remember, or a data type, int, double, float. One particular characteristic of the constructors do not have static, and the constructors do not have void or any other data type. The constructor is the only method that is allowed to do not have a data type. And therefore, in consequence, you cannot use the keyword return inside of the constructor. Did you notice all this chain of consequences? So, a constructor in a class is going to look like this, public and the name of the class. No static, no data type, just like that. Make sense? No data type, no static, public, name of the class, keeping the uppercase. Okay, so far, It's fine. I am sure that you are thinking, well, why do I want a constructor? Because, okay, this line is calling a constructor. Okay, this constructor, I then put the constructor there, the compiler, Java, is going to put this code there for me, and it's empty. So, well, what is going to happen is the following. You do not need to do anything with the constructors. However, I am sure that every single time that you create a class, you notice that we're doing something like the following. Every single time that we're creating an object, and you can remember a student, and you can remember a professor, and all the things that we have been working on, the question in your exam, the examples that you watch on the internet or whatever, you have this line to create an object. And then when you have the object, you start working with the variables. Put values to the variables. It just makes sense. If we have variables, we want to put initial values there. If we create a student, we want to put the name and the ID of the student or the grade. That is something that we usually do when we're programming. Something like this means that I have a class that my class is box. When you look at this, you know that, well, looks like I have a variable, can be integer, x. Looks like I have another variable. Can you put the two variables in the same line? Yes, I could put one line, x, comma, y, and the semicolon. But what? Well, I am doing two lines. It's the same? Yes, it's the same. It's used. Different ways to do the same. If I have this, and I am doing this, well, do you remember parameters? If every single time that I create an object, I am going to do this, I am using three lines, and maybe, just maybe, I would like to do something a little bit more elegant. More elegant. I am thinking about, imagine, box, whatever. One line. Create the object. And these values that are the initial values for the variables in the class, instead of using another two lines to give value to those variables, something that I can do is put the values there. Think about that student that we created before. Do you remember this? The name, the grade, the ID. It is not mandatory. You can still do what we did in the previous week, one line to create a student, and then three lines to put the initial values to the variables. The thing is, having everything in one line, and in particular, put inside of the parentheses the values like the name, the grade, and the ID for one particular student, everything in one line, or for one particular box, everything in one line. Just makes sense, looks good. And doing that need constructors. Why? Well, because for instance, for my class box, something that I can do in order to make this line here work is create a constructor, something like public, no static, no data type, the name of the class, and I cannot change that. I cannot change the name or the data type and so on. But the good news is I can put whatever I want inside of the parentheses, which means that, for instance, for this box, something that I could do is to receive two parameters. Two variables, and then I am going to be able to do something like this. And this number 5 is basically going to travel and it's going to be the value for that variable P. And this value 7 is going to travel and it's going to be the value for that variable Q. And then something that I can do inside of the body of the constructor is, well, what you want to do is 5 in X, and what you want to do is 7 in Y. Inside of the constructor, I can do X and Y. Remember, global variables inside of the class in blue. I can use them inside of the constructor, inside of the method. And I can make them equal to P and Q. The two variables that I receive. So if you notice in one line, 5 and 7 are going to travel as a parameter, are going to arrive to P and Q. And then I am going to copy P and Q in X and X and Y are these variables global in my class box. And the result doing this and this line is going to be exactly the same that what you do with these three lines here. That are constructors. That is the reason for using constructor. Make your code more elegant. That's it. It is mandatory to have constructors? No. Highly recommended. You are going to find that several of the libraries that you are going to use later that have objects, classes, use constructors. Because now, following this idea, I can show you this example. And it uses a student. And this line looks like the things that we did before. Use the parentheses empty. But if you read that line, now you can figure out that, okay, we are creating a new student. The object, the name is going to be Bob. And Bob is going to have an ID and a GPA according with the class, right? And in particular, in one line, I am telling the computer the ID for Bob is 225 and the GPA for Bob is 4.0 in one line instead of three lines. Makes sense. Another example. Question for your exam. Can you add a constructor to the class circle that allowed me to pass as a parameter the value for the variable radius? Hopefully the question is clear, right? I give you a class, I give you some variables that are global in the class, and now I can ask for a method constructor, well, use for a constructor. And my goal is that you know what I am talking about. It's like, oh, he's asking for a constructor. Oh, this method that the only reason for them to exist is to put initial values to the variables in the class. That is the truth by definition, constructor. The goal of the constructor, put initial values to the variables of the class, period. We know the goal. Now, how to add the constructor? By default, always, always, always in your classes, without doing anything, you have this public name of the class, whatever, parentheses empty, open curly bracket, closing curly bracket. Those things in green is always in your classes, in any class that you create. I mean, you can add that or not, but there is always there. That source code is going to be there in your classes always by default. Now, what I am asking you to do is include another constructor. Something like the one that you give me in the chat. It's like, you are asking me to add a new constructor, so you are asking me to put something like public, no static, no data type, the name of the class, uppercase, parentheses. Oh, the goal is to put initial values to the variables. Okay, I have one variable here. Because I have one variable, then I need one parameter. And because the variable is integer, I need a parameter that is an integer. What name can I use there? Whatever I want. It could even be radius, but we're going to talk about that tomorrow. But for now, anything. A, use any letter, anything. Open curly bracket, closing curly bracket. What I want to do, the only thing that I want to do is to make my variable radius equal to whatever the user passes as a parameter. That is the constructor for my class circle. And again, what I put in green is something that you do not need to put in your code. What I put in green is something that is going to be there always, always, always by default. You are not going to have that in your editor, but the computer always use that green extra code. Now, are you telling me that I can have more than one constructor in my classes? Yes, you can have as many constructors as you want with only one particular rule. You can have as many constructors as you want, but the parameters should be different. Different how? Different number. In this case, I have one constructor, the one by default with no parameters, and I have one with one parameter. That is one way to make this different. Another way, different data types. Different data types? Mm-hmm. you can have another constructor that the parameter is one, but this char is different from int. Three constructors, the one by default in green and two in blue that I am using. Makes sense. Okay, if I use this program, the class that I am showing you, well, I can do any of the options that we have reviewed, right? With this class and with these constructors, something that I could do is to create an object. Circle. And I could do something like, well, I want an object circle, the name for the object, whatever, and it's going to be equal to a new object. And after the new, I am going to put again the name of the class. And I can do use empty parentheses, which are going to coincide with this one, the default. And then I can do x dot radius equal 10. I can do that. Work? Yeah, it's going to work. There is no problem because I still have this and I still have the public. Everything that we reviewed before works. However, if you do something like this, you immediately notice that is a new programmer. It's something that is doing things in a particular way that is maybe the easy way, but there are another way that is a little bit more elegant, right? The other way, the second option, is you can create a circle. I am going to use the name Y. That is going to be equal to new. And the more elegant way is, well, why not you call this constructor and you put here the 10 inside of the parentheses, which is going to be the value for A, and then it's going to be the value for radius. You know what? Everything is going to happen in the background, and basically you have one single line. Well, I have three on the screen, but you can put this in one line, and it's basically the type, the name, equal new, calling the constructor, and the value 10. Looks better. In this case, it's only one variable, but you can imagine the same example with the student, that is three variables, and other classes with several. Using the constructor looks better. Now, I also create another one, and I can use my other constructor, the one that I create with characters, and I can send a particular character, A. So, one option, and my old friend, the option use going directly with the value in the value. In this point, I want to introduce another idea. What is the reason because I am using the constructor? What is the reason because this option here could be better than this option there? What is the reason because I am talking about elegance? Well, think about the following idea. Right now, the only thing that I have in the constructor is this assignation, but you know conditions. And because you know conditions, you know that something that I can do is something like, I can add a condition inside of the method. Here, imagine that I am doing this computer graphics program, and this is my class to represent the circles. And you know what? I do not want to have circles with a radius greater than 100, because maybe I am going to use this value to draw something on the screen. And I know that the maximum value that I want to use is 100. Something that I can do is adding here a condition to validate that the value that I am receiving is below some threshold that I define. If that is true, I put that value in the radius. But if that condition is not true, remember the condition, I am going to make the radius 0. Or maybe put 99, whatever. Think about the consequences for this. If I put this condition in the method, every single time that you create a new object, the condition is going to be reviewed. So always, 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 when you create an object, you're going to be checking that the initial values for the variables are something that you expect. For instance, remember a student. A student, we have a variable grade. For the variable grade, something that I can do in the constructor of the student is to validate that the grade should be lower or equal than 100. Or if I am using letters, well, that the letters are A, B, C, D, period. It's not like your grade could be W. Makes sense. I can do validation. Now, you can tell me, you can add the same validation here. The only difference is if you put the validation here, automatically, every single time that you do this new, you are doing the validation, always, because you are calling the method and because the method has the validation. If you are doing this, maybe you forgot the condition. Or maybe sometimes you forgot the condition and another time you do not forgot. Or maybe you are copy-pasting the same condition several times and you have basically a program with several times exactly the same lines. And remember, readability. It's boring to read the same time, the same thing again and again and again. That is the reason because you think this constructor is better than my original option, the way that we have been working before. I am reading chat. There is any question? Parameters, constructors, are we fine? Okay, so one more thing. If I want to be sure that the value for my variable is always checking this condition, something that I can do is avoid the user to do something like this. Something that I can do is to limit the possibility of a programmer to modify my variable using something like this, giving a value to my variable directly. I do not want the people to do that. What can I do? The only reason because the people can do this is because my variable is public. My variable is public. Remember, public. Other file can use what I have in my file. These two are different files, two different classes. One is my class circle, and the other is my class that have the main. Two classes. The only things that one class can use from another are those things that are public. So I can do the following. Goodbye to public, and a new keyword, private. What is going to happen here? Well, when you put something private in one class, other classes cannot access that thing that is private. So just think about it. I have my class circle, and now I have 1, 2, 3 methods, the constructors, public. Anyone can use them, just like in my examples. But now I am moving the variable to private. No one can use the variable, which means that this one, if you try to do something like that, particularly this access radius using the name of the object, as we did before, this is going to be a compilation error. Are you telling me that now, because we did the variable private, the only way that we can put an initial value to the variable is mandatory using the constructor? Mm-hmm. There is no other way to do something with that variable. Why? Because the constructor is public, so you can use the constructor. And the constructor, public, can pass a value as a parameter. That is okay, because the constructor is public. And then inside of the constructor, this value is going to be copied to the variable. But that is happening inside of the class. No one from the outside is trying to access the variable directly. Because if I try to access the variable directly, I am going to receive an error, because now the variable put itself as I do not exist from others. I am private to this class. Changing the variables to private and provide methods such as the constructor is going to allow you, like in this case, to access the variable to store something. But before put something in the variable, you're going to have the opportunity to do things like validation of the data. Be sure that even though the variable is integer, the radius for the circle is a number that you need, 0 to 100. Or the grade for the student is something that you need, 0 to 100. Or the ID for the student is something that follows the rules of some number of digits, or letters are included. I don't know. You can validate that the data that you put in the variables is the data that you expect. If you're asking, or if you are going to store the age of a person in a class, well, the age cannot be greater than, I don't know, 200. Just because some values do not make sense. Constructors to add initial values to the variables. More than one constructor per class, okay. Different parameters. The constructors do not have void, do not have data type. Always they are public. What do you think happens if we make the constructor private? What happens if I change the word public for private? An error, right? Why? Because I am going to try to call the method here, and the compiler is going to tell you error. Constructor circle do not exist. Something that I recommend you to do is try put private to any of this and try to compile. Your program is not going to compile. The compiler is going to give you an error, and the error is going to be the method do not exist. And you're going to be like, is it exist? Is here or here or here? But the compiler knows that if you put something private, that something you cannot, you do not want to share that something with other files. So the file that have these lines is not going to be able to found that method or that variable that you put as private. Private is like hiding that method or hiding that variable from others. And therefore, trying to use that in a different file is going to give you a compilation error. Going back to the example, in the example that I'm sharing with you on the slide, hopefully now you can notice some new ideas. First, the private for the variables. Why? I do not want no one here to have direct access to my variables. Why? Because I want to do some validations or some checking to the values that I am going to store. So what I want is I can still create a student with this constructor. Why? Because I have this one. This one is the one that I am going to call when I do not have parameters. As you notice, I write that one. The original one is empty. I can create this one, but now I can add some instructions in the body. In this case, what happens if someone creates a student and you do not put any parameters inside? Well, by default, I am going to put, in this case, do not make any sense. Zeros are the initial values anyway, but just to give you an example, I am going to put some initial value for the ID and some initial value for the GPA, just because the other class is not giving me any value. I put something by default. It could have more sense if you put by default my GPA is 4.0 and by default my ID is 0. The ID in any case is 0, but now the GPA make more sense. The default is 4, not 0. The second one is also create an object, but this one is going to call a different constructor, the constructor with two parameters. That basically mean that this one is going to call this one. And in this one, what I want to do is to store in my variables the other two values that I am passing, 2 to 5 or 4.0. Two constructors. Good. At this point, I can introduce setters and getters. Okay, we are using the constructor to put initial values to the variable. That is good. But what happens if I want to read the variables? What happens if I want to change the value of the variable later? For instance, what happened here that I want to change the value of the ID from this object Mary that initially was 0, but now I want to put something different. Or what happened if here I want to print the ID of Bob? Well, now, because I make the two variables private, I could not use Bob.GPA, or I cannot do Bob.ID. These two now are compilation errors because I put private both variables. I do not have access to the variables because they do not exist from this file. They are in a different file. And the other file have those private. I cannot access. In Java, the recommendation, number one, put your variables private. Number two, create a constructor and use the constructor to give initial value to your variables. We already do that. Next rule, in order to access a variable, create a method with the name get and the name of the variable. For instance, the variable ID is going to have a method getID. The variable GPA is going to have a method getGPA. Notice that we have two words together. The first letter of the second word go uppercase. So for ID and for GPA, even though the name of the variables are lowercase, when I create the get method, I change the letter I and the letter G to uppercase to represent get ID, get GPA. Those methods are the getters for my class student. The getters, always, no parameters. So they are going to have use open and closing parentheses. You do not use parameters for the getters. And always, the body for the getters is one sentence. And that one sentence is the instruction return. Return what? The variable. The getter for GPA return the GPA. The getter for the ID return the ID. Remember, we are not returning the box. We are returning the value inside of the box. So return GPA is returning the four that we put there, the value in the GPA, or return ID is returning the value for the ID. The methods, the getters, are public. We can call the methods. They are public. They are available. We cannot access the variable. But because I can access the method can give me, not the variable, but the value inside of the variable. The concept is encapsulation. Think about this like you go to the register office and you can ask for some kind of document. You do not have access to take the document from the records. You have no access to the physical storage of whatever you are searching for. But you can go to this particular window and you can talk with one particular person, and that person is public, and you talk with them, and that person go inside and took the document and is able to facilitate you the document. That is the idea with this public and private. The variables, the record, the document is private. It's inside of the class, but you do not have access to take it. However, this idea of public methods is this window in which you call the method, and because the method is inside of the place, the method can take the variable, the value, and share that with you with this idea of return the value. Those are the getters. The opposite, the setters. Setters. When you create a class, for each of your variables, you create a method with the name set as a prefix. And then you can have set ID and set GPA. The setters always are void. Why? Because they do not return anything. Setters, public and void, public and void. Public, we want to use them. Void, they are not going to return anything. But they are like the constructors. They always receive one parameter. One parameter. The type for the parameter is the same type of the variable that they are taking care of. For instance, the ID is integer, the getter, the setter for the ID is going to have a parameter integer. The setter for the GPA, because the GPA is double, the setter is going to have one parameter, and that one is going to be double. And you can imagine what is going to happen. The setters are going to have one parameter, just like the constructors, but the constructor have as many as variables we have. The setters always only have one. That is the value that they are going to put in the variable. For instance, this one, the setter for ID, receive a parameter, any name, and the only instruction that the setter has is to assign that value, the one that received, to the variable that we have global, but now private. So the only way to access to the variable, to change the value, is to call that setter, like here, with something in parentheses, that something is going to travel and go inside of the class, and then inside of the class, the setter is going to copy that value to the variable that cannot be accessed directly. Similar idea with the ID and with the GPA. Advantage of this, if I want to make any validation to the data, well, there is only one point in which I need to add new source code. There is only one place in which I need to put this if, else, switch, or whatever. And that place is inside of the method setters, getters, or the constructor. Because the only way to change the value for the variable is with the constructor or with the setter. And the only way to access the value is with the getter. Makes sense. Getters, setters, and constructors. Okay, so going back to my program, if I ask you to do a class student, again, and my class student have only one variable, grade, and that variable grade is double, 0 to 100, but considering decimals. The recommendation in Java, public or private, for my variable. I can do both. The language allows me to do both. You can put there public, you can put there private. The language is okay with that. However, the recommendation, something that shows the world that you are good programmers, engineers, the rule for the variables is always, always, always the variables inside of the class should be private. Wait, we have been working with variable public during 5 weeks. Why? Because it's easy to work with variables public. All your programs was very, very easy. Public is easy. But you are telling me that the recommendation is to have them private. That is the recommendation. That is what I am asking you now to do. And the consequences is you need constructors, you need setters, and you need getters. If you put the variable public, you do not need the constructor, you do not need the getter, and you do not need the setter. And during the past 5 weeks, my goal for you was to understand variables. And I do not want 5 weeks ago to talk about getters, setters, and constructors. So easy solution, use public. You can continue doing that, but the people that read your programs is going to know that, okay, this is not someone that have experience doing programming because it's following rules for new programs. Your next step, your next level in your career is now you can start using privates for your variables. And therefore, because you are going to use privates for your variables, the next thing that you need to do is, number one, you need to give me constructors, public. You need to remember the same name of the class. You need to remember one parameter per variable. You need to remember the constructor is going to put an initial value for the variable, and that value is going to be the parameter that received. You need to remember public, void, do not return anything, the setter for the variable, that is going to receive the same parameter that the constructor. You do not need to use the same letter. Let me change the letter. Can be the same. I am going to change this to avoid confusion. The only thing that the setter do is change the value of the variable. And you need a getter. No parameters. That the only thing that do is to return the variable, the global one. This is your class, and all the things in red should be there just because now you want to have your variable private. Again, if you change the variable and you put the variable public, you can delete everything in red. But new programmers, experience. This is better. Why? Because I am taking care of the variable, because I know that the only way for someone to access the variable is here and here. And if I need to put conditions regarding the values for that variable, if condition here, and my information is safe. Just like any document that you want to access is not open to the public, any book in the library is not open to the public, you need to go talk with someone and that someone give you access, taking care that whatever is inside is safe. The key idea here in programming the fancy name for this private public things encapsulation. My variable grade is inside of a capsule. The class private. No one touch the variable unless that someone use constructors, getters, setters. That is the idea. Questions? Yes, I need to talk more about it, but you can also do the same with the class. You can do the class private, and the consequence is, as you mentioned, private classes, no one can access the class. And no one can access the class mean no one can use what is inside of that particular file. So far, okay. Well, the main idea with encapsulation is keep the information safe. Right now, our programs are how many lines? 20, 50? I think that no one have done a program with 50 lines yet. But in the real world, your programs are 100, 200, 1,000 of lines. So think about it. You have a program that could be bigger than your textbook. And suddenly, you have this variable grade, and the grade for one student is minus 50. And you need to find what is happening in the program. How is that some students have minus 50 as a final grade? The problem is that if your variables are public, any single line in the book could be the problem. Because it's like, who is doing this with the value? When you put these locks, this private and public, well, at least you know that the only way that some grade get that value is because someone called this or this. So there is only two methods that someone is calling. And you can think about, well, two methods, I can put validation in the methods, or I can search for calling to those methods. And it's going to be easy to find the problem. That is the goal for encapsulation. Separate the problem, isolate some part of the problems from others, and take care or control the access to the information. Just think about the borders between different countries. It's like option number one, everyone go in and go out in any place, which will be very complicated. So option number two, I put particular places in which you can enter or go out. So I know that if you are in or out, you should have used that particular entry point or exit point, whatever. Those entries or those access points are the constructors, setters, and getters. So if you are in or out, if you're using something from inside or you take something to the outside, you should pass for these three methods. Control, encapsulation, fancy term. So far so good. Any question regarding constructors, setters, and getters? And I promise to cover two strings tomorrow. Good. So see you tomorrow for the two string. Thank you guys. Bye.